Okay. I would like to begin my presentation on coffee banana intercropping, which is an intimate relationship with an outline. I'll first talk about the system's approach to improving livelihoods. Then I'll move to the profitability and resource matching, which justifies coffee banana intercropping. And third, I'll talk about coffee banana intercropping on the farm. Then I'll look at the benefits of coffee banana intercropping with regards to CSA, triple wins. And then I'll sum it up by talking about the challenges to adoption of coffee banana intercropping. The system's approach to improving livelihoods requires an integration of the system productivity, nutrition and equity, and the scaling and targeting. And at the plot level, we are looking at improving the overall efficiency of the production system, which requires integration of trees, livestock, crops, and so forth. And then with that, we believe that we will be impacting on household labor, nutrition, and equity. And then lastly, at plot level and household level, integration contributes to the community level by impacting on the factors that enable communities, even the nation, to remain sustainable. Profitability and resource matching is very essential. And the work we have done in Uganda shows us clearly that maize is the least profitable. And banana and coffee are more profitable than maize or even beans. And coffee in itself is a main cash crop. Banana is considered a major food crop. Now, coffee banana intercropping on the farm is basically ideal for communities that are constrained by land, but labor is adequate. The prerequisite for sustainable coffee intercropping with banana is the ability to manage the competition for nutrients and water and light. So there, from the chart above, we recognize that you can actually introduce coffee in an existing banana plantation, or bananas can be introduced in an existing coffee plantation. However, we notice that when you are to introduce coffee and bananas in a new farm, you need to manage the spacing accordingly. And lastly, we noticed that bananas will tend to be more productive within a year before coffee even starts to produce. This is an overview of the triple wins if farmers can gain from intercropping coffee with bananas. And one of them is enhanced food security and incomes. We have a reduced greenhouse gas emissions and climate change adaptation and mitigation. In detail, one of the first triple win I would like to talk about is the enhanced income. It's observed that bananas tend to provide about $10,000 in the years that coffee is not productive. In general, from this graph, we notice that when Arabica coffee is intercropped with bananas, coffee in general, the revenue is around 4,400. However, when Arabica coffee is monocropped, the revenue is just $2,600 per hectare per year, which is about double. Secondly, intercropping coffee with bananas improves yield. We notice that when Arabica and banana are shaded, the yields are almost the same quantity of yield is derived from similar to when Arabica coffee is monocropped. Coffee intercropped with bananas improves the coffee quality in that the quality of the coffee and banana are mutually enhanced through above ground and below ground complementarity. Above ground moderation by shading reduces temperature in the coffee canopy by about 2 degrees. Thirdly, shading improves physiological behavior of coffee with regards to photosynthesis and leaf area index. Coffee also produces heavier and larger cherries, which results in reduced overbearing. Because bananas are not secondary hosts of key coffee pests and diseases, the coffee banana intercrop system contributes to spatial disruption of pests and pathogen dynamics. It also contributes to the conservation and buildup of natural enemies against these pests and diseases. However, the system also contributes to the soil suppressiveness and deterrence and allelopathy. In this regard, banana shaded coffee systems experience 50% lower incidence of coffee rust, leaf rust, and black coffee twig borer than in tree shaded systems. And lastly, the coffee banana intercropping contributes to the reduction of greenhouse gases in that the CBI is among the land use systems that enhances production resource use efficiency by increasing the soil organic matter pool and stabilizes the soil organic carbon. For example, from this chart, we noticed that carbon in shade trees is much higher than in unshaded systems. However, the coffee banana intercrop system also experiences some challenges with regards to its adaptation. First, the agenda issues in relation to inequality in land ownership and limited opportunities to break into the coffee production by women. However, women are a vast proportion of labor in coffee and banana farming, but their effort is underappreciated. And secondly, there are divergent government interests with regard to coffee banana intercropping. Many governments in East and Central Africa have not yet officially endorsed coffee intercropping. This is mainly because of a misconception that monocropping is a form of agricultural modernization, which is necessary to achieve the African Green Revolution. For example, Rwandese farmers are encouraged to consolidate fragments of land parcels and grow coffee as a monocrop. Secondly, there's a high initial capital investment, mainly because coffee requires high levels of initial investment, but extended period for realization of economic returns, which is between 5 to 10 years, is unrealistic. Yet farmers like to obtain a direct and immediate return for their investment. There are also conflicting interests in the coffee sector with relation to the certification standards and sustainability criteria, which apparently differ from organization to organization. There is a limited involvement of local private sector and financial providers with regards to promotion of coffee banana intercropping. There is a lack of specific recommendations for CBI, because most of the existing recommendations are blanket developed for coffee in Myanmar and Laos, which are difficult to duplicate everywhere. And lastly, there's excessive mining of soil nutrients. For example, both coffee and banana are heavy feeders, requiring large amounts of nitrogen and potassium. which means that nutrient uptake in a plantation yielding 10 tons per year of fresh bananas, 10 tons coffee requires about 90 kilograms of nitrogen, 10 kilograms of phosphorus, and 190 kilograms of potassium per hectare. We also are faced with the unregulated field of climate change. There is a diffuse nature of coffee sector with multiple actors and unregulated climate change adaptation and mitigation of agricultural activities, which particularly slows down the uptake of intercropping in coffee. There is also a need for smallholder-centered strategies to directed towards climate adaptable, sustainable coffee production. And I would like to thank you for listening. And as a famous professor in Uganda says, take care of your bananas and your bananas.